Greetings from the Oxbow Eco Center. I'm Wren Underwood, the Senior Education Coordinator here at the Oxbow and for St. Lucie County's Environmental Resources Department. I'm here with another lesson for the St. Lucie Water Champions Initiative, which is an initiative that teaches citizens about water quality and water issues and what you can do about it. And you can find out more about St. Lucie Water Champions at stluciewaterchampions.com. So today I'm going to introduce to you this model. This is a groundwater model, and it's going to demonstrate all the things that go on under our feet, right? Out of sight, out of mind. But it's a very important model and very important concepts because what happens under the ground does affect our waterways and the water quality and the habitat quality of our local water bodies. So what you're looking at is a plexiglass kind of a tank, right? So in the back is a tank of water. It almost looks like a fish tank. And we have a little pump here, just like you would on a fish tank, that pulls up water out of this tank. And then it is released onto this little platform here that forces water over here into this front compartment. You can see this front compartment's only about an inch wide, but that's the important compartment because if you can move to the front here and see that this is what we want to really learn about is how water is moving underground. This is what this represents is all the different layers of sediment and rock that are under our feet, like I said. So in the model, here's some of the features. We have this green strip up at the top. It's here, all the way across. That green strip represents where we live and play and work. So on that green strip are our schools, our houses, our roads, our parking lots, our parks, everything up here at the surface, right? Underneath the green strip is everything under our feet. There are some other interesting elements that you can see through here, and obviously it is a cross section, right, of the earth. First of all, you might notice these tubes, they look like clear straws going down into the ground. These represent wells. And wells might, you know, some wells might be shallow. They might be something for irrigation or something like that. Other wells are sort of moderately deep, and others are much deeper, going down into the deeper aquifers. These wells are more likely to be used for drinking water by municipalities. And that's because that water down there has moved through all this rock and sediment, which acts as a filter, and the water down deep is generally cleaner than the water at the surface. Other features in this model include underground storage tanks. You can see that it's called a UST. It's underground storage tanks. Those are tanks like you might find at your local gas station. You drive over them every time you drive into a gas station parking lot. They have huge tanks that store the gasoline under the cement. Here is a representation of a septic tank, which many homes have in our area. If you're not on the city sewer line, you have a septic tank in your yard. This bowl shape is a cross-section of a lake. As we move this way, as the water's going that way, there's more wells, and then there's also a stream. And it's important to note that that stream, of course, it's a cross-section. That stream is flowing into the model, so it's flowing that way. So all the water in this model, even though you may not be able to see water between all these particles, we're going to use some dyes in a minute to show you the movement of water. All the water is moving from the input over here all the way over to the lowest point, right? Gravity pulls water to the lowest point and ends up at the stream. And that stream flows back to our water tank, which, you know, maybe that represents the ocean, right? All right, well, before we see this model actually in action, I do want to cover a few definitions for you. So you're going to hear the word groundwater and already have heard the word groundwater quite a bit. And groundwater is pretty simple, right? It's water present below the Earth's surface, like we talked about. Here's the green surface and it's water below that. You've also probably heard the word aquifer. An aquifer is basically groundwater that's stored under the ground at usually a deeper depth. And the water is contained in there in the cracks and crevices and pores of the sediments and of the rocks that are underground. And an aquifer is generally where, like I said, if we're drinking groundwater from your municipality, it's generally going to be they're tapping into these deeper aquifers. Now, we talked about water moving down through these sediments and such, and that's because the sediments and rock are permeable. Water can move through the pores in limestone, through cracks and crevices, and through the different particles of soil and rock and gravel. And different types of soil and rock have different permeability. So larger pores and cracks and crevices, obviously water is going to move through faster in that case. And the smaller pores and little particle size that have smaller spaces between the particles, water is going to move slower. And so that's important. You'll see even in this model, you can see that this is a larger particle size than this, and this is a larger particle size than this. So you can see the various kinds. So I want to call your attention also to these darker brown streaks. These represent confining layers. They're made of clay, and clay is so fine. The particle size is super, super fine that water can move through it, but extremely slowly. So for all intents and purposes, water is moving down, gravity is pulling it down, and it hits a clay layer and it practically stops, right? So these clay layers or confining layers will confine certain layers. Like you can see between here and here, right? There's some confined aquifers versus unconfined aquifers are ones that have access to the surface. And that's an important distinction. So I mentioned earlier that we tend to drink, municipalities will prefer to have a deep water well into the aquifer and supply residents with groundwater. Some municipalities do indeed use surface waters like marshes and lakes, but overall, most Floridians are going to get their water from the aquifer, from groundwater. And there's a reason for that. If you think about it, the surface water's up here, and there are some municipalities who use surface water, but surface water, because it's right here where we live, where we garden, where we drive our cars, it's much more prone to be polluted, right? Much more likely to easily be polluted by human activity. Whereas water that can move down through these sediments, through their permeable rocks and sediments, by the time it gets down here into these deeper aquifers, it's cleaner, right? And it's just a better water, drinking water source in general. So now I want to demonstrate how this model works and represents the real world. As I told you, we have this pump that's dumping water out here, and it goes into this compartment. So there's a constant flow of water right now in our model. I would like to demonstrate for you a drought. So if we think of this pump and the water that it's putting out here, we think of it as a rain event. I'm going to move this pump over here to where the rain event is happening, just sort of over here, over our ocean, if you will. So there's no more water moving onto the land here. And what I want you to notice is I do want you to watch the lake, the water level in the lake here. Might take a few minutes, but it should drop because there's no rain event. The water is percolating or soaking down in through the sediments, and even including this lake, right? It's drying out. And this happens in real life. Like I said, we are simulating a drought. We can do just the opposite, and I can make a rain event, right? Much needed rain at this point with lakes drying out. We can move our rain event back over the land. Water's going to fall onto the land and recharge, if you will, or refill up our groundwater. And that groundwater, or the water table, which is the top of the groundwater, is going to move up in the lake. If you just keep your eye on it for just a minute. Yep, there it comes. So what else can affect that level of water in the lake? Sometimes we actually can use groundwater maybe in a not as a responsible way as we should, and we can actually affect the water level in lakes just by pulling groundwater out of the ground too fast, right? Overconsumption. So I'm going to use this syringe. I'm going to put it right here in this well, and if you'll watch the lake water here, if we are using too much water too quickly, can see that it affects that lake and the water level therein. So water conservation is important. It does affect our waterways. So now we want to actually use some color. We're going to use some food dye here to color the water in various ways to show how pollution happens, right, and how it affects groundwater. We have these beautiful dyes. We've got blue, we've got red, and we've got green. And so I'm going to place them on the model, and you can see how the water moves in the groundwater and how pollution, we're going to pretend like these are types of pollution, how pollution affects our groundwater and our water bodies. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make it stop raining for now, because right now we're sort of got this constant rain event going. It's actually sort of causing some flooding here. So I am going to make it stop raining temporarily. And then I'm going to take my lovely dye, and I'm going to pretend like this is a fertilizer, right? It's green, makes grass grow really well, makes your garden grow fast, that kind of thing. And I'm going to put just a few drops of this on my model. And we're going to simulate that someone's just fertilizing. Maybe they live about a mile or so from that lake. I'm going to put 3 drops as our fertilizer. And then I'm also going to pretend that somewhere on this landscape here, someone is using some pesticide. Maybe they're treating fire ants or treating for roaches or weeds. And we're going to put that on our landscape as well as that happens. So again, just a few drops. And then I'm going to use the lovely blue dye. And we're going to think about our lovely septic tank and underground storage tanks. When these things work properly, they're great, right? Problem is sometimes they don't work properly. They may have leaks. They may have a faulty system somehow, and we're going to pretend that's the case. And so we're going to use the blue dye. There's an underground storage tank. There's a septic tank that may not be working properly. And now it doesn't look like too much is being affected, except, well, gravity's pulling some things down, right? You can see gravity working and the permeability of this sand in here. These are very small particle sizes, very small spaces between the particles, but still, this liquid is making its way down into the groundwater. It's away from humans. It doesn't seem to be as much of an issue for us. But what happens then when we have a rain event? Well, let's find out. Here's our rain. Rain is a universal solvent. That means almost everything will dissolve in it, right? And that which cannot be dissolved in it still gets carried by its flow, like leaves and sticks and things like that. But these things that we put on the land are easily dissolved and carried by water. Now, if you pan over and look at the lake, you'll see, remember, our water is moving here from right to left. And you can see that what we did a mile, 2 miles, 3 miles away from that lake is affecting that lake directly. It won't happen as fast in real life as it did in our model, but you can see it has quite an effect. And if you wait just a minute, it's going to make its way. As I say, it's going from right to left. It's going to make its way to our stream as well. So this is showing that we have a direct impact on our waterways. What we do on the land is going to impact our waterways. And so it's very important for us to do things like follow our fertilizer ordinances, right? So June 1st through September 30th, there's no fertilizer on your lawn or in your garden, no synthetic fertilizer. And that protects our waterways because it's the rainy season. A lot of times it's going to rain almost every day in the summer, and this is what happens. And so to protect our waterways, we have that ordinance, and that's a very important ordinance. And this also shows you to, you know, use your pesticides and things, use them cautiously. Read the label. If you don't need to use them, don't just use them just because. Other things that can move and move this way with the water and end up in our watershed and in our groundwater are nutrients and things from pet waste, right? So it's helpful to pick up pet waste as well. Now, what you've seen is contamination of this sort of surficial groundwater, right? Given enough time, you're still seeing that, yes, it's moving that way to our lowest point, but gravity is still pulling it downward, too. So you can see that it's gone from up here. It's contaminating deeper and deeper. As a matter of fact, right here, it looks like this more shallow well is already contaminated. Let's see if I pull. Yep. So shallow wells, closer to the surface, easy to contaminate, right? Our deeper wells, like this one and this one over here, are a little harder to contaminate. It can happen. With enough time, you can imagine this is going to go through, even through the confining layers, even though that might take a really long time, right? But it can reach our deeper aquifers. To show this more quickly, I'm going to also demonstrate a deep water injection over here. And so I'm going to use our green dye again, I believe. I have more of that. And we are going to simulate somehow this well, either purpose or accidentally, being contaminated. And there, that aquifer, that deeper aquifer, is contaminated. The well's contaminated, the aquifer's contaminated, and you can see the movement, right? This sort of oblong shape is called a plume. There is really no good way to clean up a plume once it's down here in the groundwater in an aquifer. The best you can do is basically suck up and clean out the well. But I want you to see where it's going. Now, what if this deep well, we said deep wells are often for municipalities, and you can see how easily, right, that could be a drinking water well. And it's now contaminated from something that could have happened, you know, 15 miles upstream. So what I want you to get from this is that groundwater, it's a little harder to contaminate and get polluted, but it is possible if we're irresponsible and not careful. And I want you to understand that groundwater doesn't just sit there, right? Water under the ground, just like here on the surface, it's always moving. It's moving to the lowest point. It just moves a lot slower than it does here on the surface. It's not like a, you know, rapids or a rushing stream, but it does move. And so that was a good visual to show that. As you can see, what we do here on land affects our groundwater, affects our surface water, and the water quality therein, and also the habitat that supports local wildlife and our quality of life. So please join us to learn more about what you can do and to prevent these kinds of things and be a responsible citizen. Help us take care of our local waterways and our precious Indian River Lagoon. You can find more information about the St. Lucie Water Champions program at stluciewaterchampions.com. I'm Wren Underwood with the Oxbow Eco Center. Thank you for joining me for this training.